Here is a 50-year-old female who is a homemaker coming from Ram Colony, Kalasipalya, Bangalore. Her socio-economic status is lower middle class. Date of admission was 2nd March and she was examined on 3rd March. She comes with chief complaints of breathlessness since 6 months, palpitations since 6 months, swelling of bilateral lower limbs since 1 week. History of presenting illness. A patient was apparently asymptomatic 6 months ago when she noticed breathlessness, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive such that initially there was no limitation of activity, but there was breathlessness on exertion, such as climbing 2 to 3 flights of stairs. This corresponds to NYHA class 2. It had progressed over the next 5 months such that there was marked limitation of activity. That is NYHA class 3. Now the breathlessness would get aggravated on exertion and get relieved on taking rest. She also complains of breathlessness after around 2 hours of sleeping in the night. After which she wakes up gasping for breath. It gets relieved on sitting up for a while, suggestive of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. The breathlessness had further progressed in the past month, such that she has breathlessness even at rest, NYHA class 4, and worsens immediately after lying supine, suggestive of orthopnea. There is no history of these. Patient also complains of palpitations since 6 months, insidious in onset, gradually progressive. The patient experienced palpitations only on exertion, lasting for about 5 minutes, which was regular in rhythm and was relieved on rest. Currently, she feels palpitations even at rest and sometimes felt even during sleep during the past 3 or 4 weeks, which is regular in rhythm. The palpitations were not associated with post-palpitational diuresis. Around 3 months back, she was taken to a local hospital for the above complaints. She was diagnosed to have a heart condition and was told that she might require surgery for the same. She was prescribed oral medication which helped relieve her symptoms. She recently stopped taking the medications around 1 month back. She has developed painless symmetrical swelling of bilateral lower limbs since 1 week. Which was initially at the level of her ankles and has progressed up to her mid-calves, which partially reduced on limb elevation. There is no history of swelling in any other part of the body. No history of chest pain, syncope, or bluish discoloration of the skin and the mucous membranes, that is cyanosis. No history of cough or hemoptysis, no history of fever, no history of abdominal distension or abdominal pain. Past history. Sir, shall I continue or? Hello?
Yeah, you can continue the past history. Yeah, continue with the past history.
Okay, sir. Past history, no history of fever. Fever-associated migratory joint pains, involuntary movements in childhood. No history of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, asthma, tuberculosis, or epilepsy. No history of previous hospitalization or long-term medication or surgeries. Personal history, her diet was mixed, appetite was normal, sleep is disturbed, bowel and bladder activity is normal and regular. No health affecting habits such as smoking, tobacco consumption, alcoholism or drug abuse. Menstrual and obstetric history. She attained menarche at 12 years, regular and normal menstrual cycle since then. She attained menopause at 48 years, that is 2 years ago. Obstetric history, she gave birth to 2 children, one 23 years back and the other 24 years back. Both the pregnancies were uneventful. Both were normal vaginal deliveries with no complaints during or immediately after labor. Family history, she was born out of a non-consanguineous marriage, no family history of sudden cardiac death, no history of heart diseases in the family. Treatment history, she was diagnosed with a heart condition 2 months back and was prescribed oral medication for her symptoms. She has not been taking the medications regularly for the past 1 month. Summary, a middle-aged female who is a homemaker.
You can come back to the, come back to the first slide.
Yes, sir.
The second one. Okay, so here we have a 50-year-old female who has come with breathlessness, palpitations, and bilateral low limb swelling. So if you take up the first symptom that's there, that's breathlessness. So
yes,
it's a 6 months duration of breathlessness, isn't it? Six
yes.
months duration of breathlessness in a 50-year-old female. So what are the possibilities that you would want to think of when she comes with breathlessness for 6 months?
So breathlessness of 6 months, there could be left ventricular dysfunction.
Okay.
Congestive cardiac failure. Since it is associated with paroxysmal.
Okay, so left ventricular.
Yes, sir.
Okay, the symptoms were associated with paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. So you think it is a cardiac disease that is there.
Yes.
And the cardiac disease you want to consider is left ventricular failure.
Yes, sir.
So that is one symptom which could be due to the left ventricular failure. Any other cause of breathlessness?
Sir, anemia.
Okay, it could be anemia. Okay.
Yes,
it could be anemia. So that is possibility. Again, anemia would cause breathlessness either due to left ventricular failure. So that could be one. Yes. Any other possibility?
Any of the valvular heart diseases. Progressive.
Again, that is left ventricular failure itself, isn't it? Once you've said the etiology for left ventricular failure could be many other causes. So one possibility you told me is left ventricular failure. Second, you told me is anemia. Any other possibilities which can explain the dyspnea for 6 months duration? You want to consider respiratory disease?
Sir, since it's associated with PND, respiratory disease is not really easy.
Since it's associated with PND, you think respiratory disease is less likely? Okay,
less
so
likely.
That is one thing that could be there, but you could have coexisting diseases. So if it's a respiratory disease, what could be the respiratory disease? Which can cause
COPD.
Okay, you could have a chronic obstructive. But again, the dyspnea, to say respiratory disease, to say chronic, what's the duration that's needed to say it's a chronic respiratory disease?
So more than 18
COPD
months.
By definition?
Oh, 3 years.
COPD by definition? At least 2 years minimum that should be there. 2 years minimum should be there for a chronic dyspnea that should be there in a respiratory disease. But yes, it could be a little, maybe if you could ask the further history, she might say some dyspnea. So respiratory can be there. Okay. So the way to differentiate respiratory versus cardiac dyspnea, how do you differentiate that?
Sir, association of.
Whether it is a respiratory? Association of?
In respiratory, there will be association of sputum production, cough, wheeze.
Okay.
Whereas in cardiac breathlessness, there is palpitation, angina, PND, orthopnea.
Okay. Okay. So the two important things that are very specific for a cardiac is PND and angina. So PND is, as your history says, that there is some sort of a PND that you're telling in the history that this patient has. The other symptom that is very specific for a cardiac is angina. So angina, if the patient would have had and there is dyspnea, then your cardiac breathlessness would have been there. Remember this cough, the sputum can be there in both respiratory and cardiac. Can you tell me some causes of cardiac, causes of sputum or coughs?
Sir, pulmonary hypertension causing pulmonary edema and thing for the sputum.
Okay, pulmonary edema, not pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary edema itself, pulmonary edema. That could be due to left ventricular failure or it could be due to left atrial failure. So any of those conditions can produce sputum. So cardiac causes also can produce sputum. Again, palpitation is not specific for the heart. Why? Why palpitation is not a specific feature for a cardiac disease? What
sure,
does palpitation
sir.
Mean to you?
Palpitation is uncomfortable awareness of one's own heartbeat, which may be due to increase the change in the rate or the rhythm or the volume of the heart.
Yeah, so it could occur due to the change in the rate, or it could occur due to the change in the rhythm, or it could occur due to the change in the force of contraction. Now, this could occur due to non-cardiac diseases also. So palpitations can occur due to non-cardiac diseases. What are the non-cardiac diseases that could get palpitation? Which non-cardiac disease you do get palpitations?
Any disease which causes change in the heart rate leading to change in the rate, sir, like pneumonia?
Yeah, what conditions? Examples. Anemia, yes, you could get it in anemia. Force of contraction will increase. What are the other conditions where the heart rate would increase?
Sir, hyperthyroidism.
Yes, you could get it in hyperthyroidism. Drugs, you said drugs. What are the drugs which will increase the heart rate? Tachycardia. Common drugs which cause tachycardia? Beta agonist, isn't it? Somebody is on inhalers, they can have tachycardia, could be there due to that. Common drugs which we use, salbutamol or deriphyllin or any of those inhalers which is used, that can produce tachycardia. So tachycardia could be there due to that. Even bradycardia can cause palpitation, or only tachycardia causes palpitation?
Even bradycardia can cause palpitation.
Okay, bradycardia also causes palpitation. So tachycardia and bradycardia, the change in the rate is not specific for the cardia. It could occur due to non-cardiac causes also. And more often with respiratory diseases, chronic respiratory diseases, what happens when you have a chronic respiratory disease? What is the pathogenesis why they have palpitations?
Hypoxia, sir.
Hypoxia. So they will generally could have hypoxia that could be there, which can cause more palpitation. Okay. What is the classical arrhythmia that you get in case of chronic respiratory disease? Which is that arrhythmia that you get in COPD patients with hypoxia, as you said?
I'm not sure.
Okay. It could be something called as a multifocal atrial tachycardia. So you get something called as MAT. Multifocal atrial tachycardia, which is common whenever there is hypoxia. Even atrial fibrillation is common, and any supraventricular tachycardias, SVTs, are common whenever there is hypoxia. So in respiratory diseases, you get palpitations due to drugs. It could occur due to hypoxia, change in rhythm. That's maybe specific for the heart. But again, you know, atrial fibrillation can occur due to many other causes. Whatever causes you told for tachycardia can cause atrial fibrillation also, as well as alcohol can cause atrial fibrillation. You could get tumors like pheochromocytoma, which can cause atrial fibrillation. So again, arrhythmias may not be specific for the heart, but the rhythm disturbances could be more common with cardiac diseases. Okay.
Yes, sir.
The change in the volume, as you said, the change in the volume, is it specific for the heart or the force of contraction? If I say there is change in force of contraction, or is it also seen with non-cardiac causes?
I think it can be seen with non-cardiac causes also, sir. If there is...
It can occur due to high output states, isn't it? Can
yes,
you tell
sir.
Me the high output states? Can you name the high output states?
Thyrotoxicosis, anemia.
Yes. Yes. Severe anemia, not only anemia, severe anemia. Thyrotoxicosis, correct? Some more? Some more causes? Pregnancy, isn't it? Pregnancy, you can get it.
Pregnancy.
Any vitamin deficiency which produces high output state?
Beriberi, sir.
Yes, wet beriberi. You could get it in wet beriberi. You can also get it in case of AV fistulas. You can get it in case of cirrhosis of liver. So you have a high output states where you could get an increased force of contraction. Otherwise, it could be due to a chamber enlargement. So any chamber of the heart enlarging can produce palpitations. So though palpitations are more common with cardiac diseases, palpitations can be seen with non-cardiac diseases also. So it's not necessary that it is a symptom of cardiac disease. Though your patient has palpitations and you said it is regular palpitations, so it could be due to any of these causes. It could be due to any of these causes, starting from anemia, or it could be due to a respiratory disease also. You said this patient has PND. Can you go to that slide where you told about PND?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So why do you believe this is PND? Why do you say this is paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea? What made you feel that this is?
Sir, it is classical, like after the patient sleeps for 2 hours, when he that is when he goes to gets his REM sleep, which causes. I'll tell the mechanism, sir.
So, yeah. So what is a very specific feature to say it's PND? He wakes up from breathing. She wakes up from the sleep.
It gets better on sitting.
Okay, so the patient wakes up with severe dyspnea, okay? Dyspnea or a sense of a doom that they feel, and they get up and then they sit up with their legs hanging down, or they go up to the window standing there and take a good breath. Only then it relieves. It relieves with that. So what are the differential diagnoses which could get this paroxysmal breathlessness at night? What else can produce this sort of feature?
Obstructive sleep
apnea. What are the other conditions where you could have nighttime breathlessness?
Obstructive sleep apnea.
Obstructive sleep apnea. Yes, that is one thing that where they can become breathless. Correct. Can it be bronchial asthma? Will they become breathless at night? Bronchial asthmatics.
Yes, sir.
So how do you differentiate whether it is bronchial asthma or it is LV failure? What time the bronchial asthma severe exacerbation happens usually?
Usually, sir, PND happens almost 1.5 to 2 hours after sleeping, but bronchial asthma happens in the morning, sir.
Correct. Yeah, bronchial asthma happens in the morning, yes. Right. What's the other important difference between bronchial asthma and cardiac asthma? Supposedly, the patient wakes up with the breathlessness due to bronchial asthma. What happens after that? Will it get relieved like this, just by sitting up and putting the legs down?
No.
What will be there?
No, sir.
The patient will have to take? He will have to take the medications. He will have to take a bronchodilator. He will have to use his inhaler. Only then will he be able to sleep. Otherwise, he will remain breathless continuously. Does not relieve on anything other than medications. So bronchial asthma, the patient becoming breathless has to take a reliever medication. So an inhaler has to be taken or some oral medications have to be taken. Only then the patient will become better. Otherwise, the patient will remain breathless. He will not be able to go to sleep. Whereas in LV failure, as you said, in PND, the cardiac asthma, the patient becomes breathless even without medications. The moment the patient sits up, and within a few minutes, the patient becomes better. So the patient will be able to go back to sleep without medications also if it is mild. If it is severe, then they will not be able to sleep. The other differential diagnosis, as you said, is obstructive sleep apnea. So what? How will you differentiate that? OSAS can have it, you said.
So change in the position. While the person is sleeping.
Okay, they become breathless. They actually do not wake up with breathlessness, isn't it? They become apneic. Not necessarily the apnea wakes them up. Somebody else would notice them that they are not breathing. So they may not wake up in the night. Wake up in the because of that. There's no dyspnea as such. But yes, they can have breathing difficulty, snoring, etc. could be there. And when they wake up in the morning, they might feel that they are still tired. They can have headaches and all those things early in the morning. Yes, they could have history of snoring, and it could happen immediately. Immediately, moment they go into the initial phases of sleep only. And to certain extent, that could get relieved when they lie on lateral position. On lateral position, OSAS symptoms might become better. Become better. The other differential diagnosis, what are the other differential diagnosis when a patient wakes up in the middle of the night? Patient wakes up with severe sweating. It could be nightmares. It could be nightmares, REM phenomena. It could be due to hypoglycemia. Supposedly somebody is on insulin, a diabetic patient on insulin. Okay. They can have nocturnal hypoglycemia and they can wake up with this sense of breathlessness and sweating.
Yes.
Okay, all these and a very common symptom of gastroesophageal reflux disease, GERD, isn't it? GERD can manifest at night when the patient goes down to sleep. The patient will have hacking cough that comes, and because of that, the patient can wake up. So these would occur immediately, maybe. GERD will not take 2 hours to onset. It would manifest maybe within the first hour itself. So these are all the things that you have to be keeping in mind that it is PND, because PND is a very specific feature of left heart failure. If that is there, your heart failure diagnosis is almost certain there. And again, remember, PND is a feature of left heart failure. What's the difference between left heart failure and left ventricular failure? Is it the same? Why did I say
Yes,
left
sir.
heart failure? Why didn't I not say left ventricular failure? Anything else in the left side can fail other than left ventricle? You can have left atrial failure, isn't it? Which condition you get left atrial failure? Left ventricle is normal, but only left atrium fails.
Mitral stenosis, sir.
Yes, mitral stenosis, isn't it? Mitral stenosis, left ventricle is normal. So left atria is failing. So PND is a feature of a left-sided heart failure, both left ventricle as well as left atrial failure. It does not mean only left ventricular failure. In MS, you do get PND in the early part of the disease because of left atrial failure. So it's very specific. So to say PND, you have to be very clear the patient. And many a times what happens with all these cardiac patients is that you would have asked so many times the histories and you would have asked the symptom, especially your chronic valvular heart disease patients who are regular exam cases and all those things. You keep on asking the history and they generally saying yes, they will end up saying yes for all these PND symptoms, may not have actual PND. So it could be because of that also. But yes, when you're having a PND here, you have class 4 dyspnea, you said. Why do you say this is class 4?
There is dyspnea even on rest, sir. Mark limitation of
Okay, so
activity
dyspnea
and
and
dyspnea on
rest. If
rest.
supposedly somebody has orthopnea, orthopnea is equivalent to what stage of heart failure? What stage of dyspnea? This patient has orthopnea.
Stage 4, sir.
Yeah. Orthopnea itself is stage 4. So somebody has orthopnea, patient is lying down and has dyspnea. That means it is stage 4 itself. Okay.
Yes, sir.
You said there is no history of V's. Why have you told that?
Sir, to rule out the respiratory cause of breathlessness like bronchial asthma.
So does V's rule out cardiac disease?
No, sir, not completely.
You
Sir,
can get V's
respiratory.
even in PND, isn't it? Even in PND, when there is cardiac asthma, when there is fluid in the alveoli which is there, you can get V's even in cardiac disease also. So V's does not differentiate whether it is cardiac or respiratory, but V's is more common with respiratory disease. V's can even get, you can get V's even in cardiac asthma when there is PND itself, pulmonary edema. You can get V's there. There is inflammation, some sort of thing that happens there. You could get V's even in cardiac. But yes, it's more specific for the respiratory disease. Yes, you can go to the next slide.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here you have said that the patient was diagnosed to have some cardiac disease and was told that she requires surgery, but she started on medications. Now it's very important in a cardiac patient, you should ask for what type of medications or some more details of the medications, because based on that, you'll be able to tell what these patients are on. So what are the common cardiac medications a patient would be put on generally?
Sir, diuretics,
Diuretics, yes. Then
AC inhibitors, ARBs,
okay, ACE inhibitors, yes. Then beta
beta
blockers, correct? Correct.
blockers,
Then any other oral medications? If
digoxin.
supposedly somebody is, yes, digoxin, the patient can be put on digoxin, yes. And if they are in atrial fibrillation,
Any other
anticoagulant.
medications?
Anticoagulant, isn't it? Warfarin could be there. So warfarin could be there.
Anticoagulants.
So these are the common drugs they would be put on. And if it is an ischemic heart disease, antiplatelets, isn't it? Aspirin,
aspirins,
statin,
aspirin,
yeah, aspirin and statin, all those things would have been put. So you should ask for, at least try to ask for what medications. If they know it, they may tell you. Otherwise, at least some medications you'll be able to tell what is the mechanism based on what happens after they take the medication.
Yes,
like
sir.
Diuretics, isn't it? Diuretics,
diuretics,
moment they
yeah.
take the diuretics, they will pass urine more. So they would say that the urine output is increased. Their weight will decrease because the fluid water log disappeared. The water logging will decrease. The leg swelling will decrease. So diuretics, they'll be definitely able to tell you. Warfarin, how do you get history of warfarin? Supposedly somebody has been started on warfarin. Any particular history can tell you that this patient is on warfarin? What would they ask them to do? What would they ask them to do if supposedly on warfarin is to be taken? It's an anticoagulant, isn't it? So, would you monitor something when somebody is on warfarin? You monitor the PTINR, isn't it? You generally monitor the PTINR to adjust the dose of warfarin. And warfarin is given once daily. Most often it's given in the evening. Most often we give warfarin in the evening. And you tell the patient to do monitoring of the PTINR because the warfarin can cause the INR can get prolonged, and because of that they can have bleeding. So at least in the initial phases they monitor it daily, but afterwards at least they should be monitoring it weekly or once in 15 days. So INR test. So the patient will be knowing that they have to do this INR test. Okay, PTINR test would have been told to them and they would be doing that, and based on that the dose would be adjusted. Also, warfarin has a lot of interaction with what? Warfarin will have a lot of interaction with food, isn't it? So food interactions, lot of food substances interactions are there with warfarin. Especially you have a lot of vegetables, a lot of fruits, grapefruit and all those things. So sometimes they would be asked to avoid certain food substances when they are on warfarin because the coagulating property of that can worsen with that. So warfarin effective. So warfarin, basically you will be able to get out if the patient says the blood has to be monitored. Okay, the blood has to be monitored. INR has to be monitored. Yes. What about digoxin? How do you make out the patient is on digoxin? How is digoxin given? Digoxin is a drug which has a cumulative effect, isn't it? It's stored in the liver. So how do you give digoxin? You give it only 5 times a week. 5 times a week. 2 days off. So the patient is asked to take from Monday to Friday, and Saturday and Sunday the drug is skipped. So there is a drug holiday has to be given. So digoxin is, these are very few drugs which require drug holiday. And if somebody is on digoxin, you'll be able to make out that, you'll be able to tell that this drug, the patient will tell that it's been told to take only 5 times a week. And many of the patients would know the names of the drugs also. If they are on chronic medication, they would be on that. And so some histories, because based on that, if supposedly somebody is on warfarin, that means we know this patient has atrial fibrillation. If somebody is on digoxin, we know that this patient is on atrial fibrillation. If there is a diuretic, then we know that the patient has developed heart failure. So based on the drugs that the patient is taking, we will be able to make out that these are the complications the patient already has. Also, if you're considering a rheumatic fever or rheumatic heart disease in your history, what else drug which they will be on if it is rheumatic?
Penicillin, sir.
Penicillin. So again, you'll have to tell that there is no history of taking monthly injections or once in 3 weeks injections penicillin. Again, patients who have been diagnosed to a cardiac disease due to valvular heart disease, rheumatic, would be on penicillin for lifetime. So all that histories have to be a little more detailed, especially the drugs and whether the symptoms have improved or not. Okay. So that is a little more details about the drugs is required. Yes. Go on to the next slide.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you said about the painless swelling of bilateral lower limbs. So why do you think this is, what is the cause for this? Supposedly we consider it as a cardiac disease. What's the cause for bilateral lower limb swelling?
Sir, there is right heart failure, which could lead to forward failure and forward, no, sir, backward failure. Sorry, sir. Right heart failure.
Okay, so fine. It's the sign of right heart failure.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there is a right heart failure is a sign. It could occur due to left heart failure also because of secondary hyperaldosteronism. So secondary hyperaldosteronism can occur and that can produce the edema in these patients. So that could be the feature that could be there. Okay, so you said it's a painless swelling and you said that there is no abdominal distension and pain. That is again to rule out right heart failure possibly.
Yes,
and loose discoloration, again, in adults, it is little difficult to get this history. Even if there is a cyanotic heart disease, it's pretty difficult to get this loose discoloration of mucous membrane history. Again, when you say the chest pain, it is better to specifically say angina. Okay, angina and chest pain are two different things. Chest pain could be due to other causes also. Angina is the symptom which is specific for cardia. So
yes,
angina, there is no history suggestive of angina. That would be the better word in place of chest pain. What about syncope? Supposedly somebody comes with syncope. What are the common causes that you would want to rule out?
Syncope, left heart forward failure, sir, aortic stenosis, aortic regurgitation, sir.
Okay. So it is basically syncope could be due to low cardiac output, decreased cardiac output. That could be the common cause. And most often the decreased cardiac output would occur due to stenotic lesions, aortic stenosis, where you have the prototype symptom. If there is one valvular heart disease which has syncope as a manifestation, you will want to rule out aortic stenosis. That's a symptom which comes with aortic stenosis. You could get syncope. Tachycardias also, arrhythmias also can produce syncope because there will be a gap that is there. Post arrhythmia, you could get certain pauses and that can produce syncope. You could get syncope due to non-cardiogenic causes. More importantly, what are the causes where you could get syncope? Non-cardiac.
Sir, hypoglycemia.
More importantly, hypotension.
Hypotension.
There is supposedly the BP drops due to certain causes. Could be due to a bleed. Could be due to autonomic dysfunction. You could get syncope because of that also. So syncope can have neurogenic, it could have systemic causes, it could be cardiac causes also. So again, it's not specific, but yes, more often you can get it in cardiac disease also. Hemoptysis, what's the relevance in cardiovascular system? Hemoptysis?
Pulmonary edema, sir.
Okay, it could be due to pulmonary edema. What are the other causes of hemoptysis? One is pulmonary edema, agreed. Cardiac causes. I'm talking about cardiac causes. Cardiac causes of hemoptysis. Pulmonary edema is correct. What else in the as a sequelae of pulmonary edema can you get?
Mitral stenosis.
In mitral stenosis, you get, isn't it? You get hemoptysis,
yes,
due to what mechanisms?
Sir,
one is pulmonary edema.
Left atrial pressure.
Yeah, left atrial pressure will cause pulmonary edema itself. What else? Anything else can it cause? Have you heard of an entity called as pulmonary apoplexy?
Yes.
Pulmonary apoplexy. What do you mean by pulmonary apoplexy? That is one of the lethal conditions where bleeding can be massive and the patient can die due to that bleeding. Pulmonary apoplexy is a condition where there is anastomosis or there is communication that forms between the pulmonary and the bronchial circulation. So whenever there is a pressure that is increased in the pulmonary side, the pressure, you could have AV malformations that are formed between the pulmonary and bronchial. And if that pulmonary, those AV malformations bleed, what will happen? The bleeding will be from the systemic circulation. The bronchial circulation will bleed, and that will be liters together, because that's a systemic circulation. The patient can die because of that. And that can happen due to mitral stenosis. That can happen due to congenital shunt lesions. Okay, shunt lesions also can produce this pulmonary apoplexy, and some per se AV malformations can also produce. So those also can cause hemoptysis. Long-standing mitral stenosis, you get a complication in the lung called as pulmonary hemosiderosis. Okay, pulmonary hemosiderosis. And that can also cause hemoptysis. Patient with congenital shunt lesions, ASD, etc., there is a lot of blood that is pooling in the pulmonaries, and they are prone to develop infections. So they are prone to develop pneumonias, and that can also produce hemoptysis. And patients with anticoagulants can per se have bleeding from the various structures there in the lung, and that can produce hemoptysis also. So hemoptysis, as you said, the pink frothy sputum is the most common cause. That is your left ventricular failure, but you could get other causes of cardiac hemoptysis also. Okay, you're told about no history of fever. Why?
Sir, infective endocarditis.
Okay, infective endocarditis is one. Any other? Rheumatic fever, isn't it? Rheumatic fever. Can you have rheumatic fever at this age, 50-year-old female?
Acute rheumatic fever, no, sir.
That's it.
Hello.
Rheumatic fever at this age, at the age of 50.
No, sir.
Okay, again, remember, in the West, it has been told, or in the Western literature, all your Western literature says that rheumatic fever is unlikely above the age of 40. Okay, above the age of 40, rheumatic fever is unlikely. In India, or in places like India, rheumatic fever can occur anytime. So you can have rheumatic fever above the age of 40 also. But in West, they believe that after the age of 40, you do not get the first episode of rheumatic fever. That's why they stop the infective endocarditis prophylaxis at 40 years of age. But in India, we continue it for lifetime. Okay, lifetime. Yeah. So that is why rheumatic fever. You could have drug fever also. You could have a lot of drugs which can produce fever. And it could be due to other causes also. Yes. You can go on to the next slide.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, you got history of associated with migratory joint pains in childhood. That is for?
Acute traumatic.
Why have you asked that history?
Sir, acute traumatic
fever. Okay, so past history of acute traumatic fever. Fine. So no history of diabetes, hypertension, asthma. So again, these are all risk factors. Diabetes and hypertension?
Yes, sir, risk factors.
What are they? Risk factors for what disease?
Ischemic heart disease.
Which? Risk factors for which disease? Which cardiac disease? Ischemic heart disease.
Ischemic heart
so it could
disease.
Be due to that. So diabetes, hypertension. Yes. Fine. So these could be the negative histories that you have taken. Fine. Can proceed. Next slide.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Anything specific here that you would want to infer from the personal history?
Sir,
it's a female. You do not have any addictions here. So otherwise, some of the addictions can have a cardiac bearing. Bowel and bladder, again, remember, when the patient is on diuretic, obviously the urinary frequency will increase. Supposedly somebody is on diuretics and you say that the bladder habits are regular, I mean, the same as earlier, then it does not mean. So supposedly somebody is on diuretic, their frequency of urination would be more. Sleep will be disturbed because of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. And generally the cardiac patients have a lower appetite. Okay, they have a lower appetite basically because the congestion of the GI tract happens. There is a heart failure that's happening. The GI, entire GI mucosa, from the stomach onwards below, is congested. So absorption is decreased. And because of that, they will have a decreased appetite, generally, okay? Not necessarily, it is general features. Okay, next slide.
Yes.
Okay, so the menarche, and she has menopause has occurred. So this is a postmenopausal lady. So they are, what are they prone for, postmenopausal females?
Ischemic heart disease.
What sort of cardiac disease? Ischemic heart disease. Any ischemic diseases, they are prone for postmenopausal. Okay. Obstetric history, you said that, yes. Again, one word which I think you should be careful in writing, obstetric history, both the pregnancies were uneventful. What do you mean by uneventful?
There were no complications, sir.
So pregnancy is delivery is a major event, isn't it? So you can't say that there was no event happening there. The labor, all those things, and the baby being born is, it cannot be said as uneventful. I don't know what many of them use this word, uneventful. Pregnancy cannot be said as uneventful. You can say that there was no complications, okay? Do not use that word, uneventful pregnancies. It's a wrong usage of the word there, okay? So yes. What's the relevance of these deliveries? You have described it that she had normal vaginal deliveries. So what's the importance of that? Is it relevant?
No,
or you've just taken it in the part of, as a part of the history you've taken?
Yes.
Or is it relevant in this patient?
I don't think it is.
Is it relevant or no?
No, sir.
No. You don't think so it's relevant? Supposedly somebody has a valvular heart disease. Valvular heart disease. And
it will get aggravated during pregnancy, sir. Stenosis, mitral
very
stenosis.
Very important. Stenotic lesions will manifest. When do they manifest? In which term or which trimester will they manifest? At what trimester generally they become breathless? MS patients.
Second trimester.
End of the second trimester, again around possibly, sometimes they can get manifest around 30 to 32 weeks of period. The second trimester is where they predominantly get manifested. The regurgitant lesions are well tolerated. So if supposedly somebody has undergone a normal delivery and she had no complications during delivery that's happened there, and she has a heart disease, it's more likely to be a regurgitant lesion rather than stenotic lesions. So stenotic lesions, they do not tolerate during pregnancy. So pregnancies, it's very important because you should know that the natural history of a valvular heart disease, if it is rheumatic, obviously the first episode of rheumatic fever would have occurred in childhood, isn't it? Early childhood, that the first episode of rheumatic fever would have occurred. It wouldn't happen at later. And the valvular heart disease, if you see the natural history of the disease, would be 10 to 15 to 20 years. So it would have started at that time. And pregnancy is a very big event in the female's life during which the cardiac disease can get manifest. So you should always ask for that. And if they have undergone a hospital delivery, they would have obviously evaluated and told her to, if she had a significant heart disease, what advice would they give it to her? What advice would have been given? If she had a significant heart disease during the first pregnancy, what would they tell her?
Not sure.
Okay, the pregnancy would have been terminated, but what advice? Would they ask her to conceive again?
No,
they obviously tell her not to, no? They would obviously not tell her to conceive again. Very important. Because pulmonary hypertension, whichever disease, be it mitral stenosis or mitral regurgitation, once the patient develops the back pressure and pulmonary hypertension is one of the biggest risk factors of complications that could happen during pregnancy. So pulmonary hypertension is one of the contraindications. Okay, the patient should not get pregnant, and they would tell her definitely to avoid pregnancies. And what would they have told her? How she will avoid pregnancies?
Tubectomy, sir.
Tubectomy, okay. Tubectomy is a surgery, okay. If she's undergoing a cesarean section, possibly they would have taken a consent and finished the tubectomy off. Otherwise, will they ask her to take IUCDs? IUDs? Intrauterine devices?
Yes, sir.
Will they ask her that as a method as contraception? or any other method of contraception. Again, remember, when there is a valvular heart disease, there is a nidus where it can get infected. So IUD is one of the important source of infections. The infection can start from there and can spread into the body, and then the valve can get further damaged. So definitely they should not be put on intrauterine devices. They can use barrier methods or any other methods, or they can tell the husband to undergo the surgery for contraception. But IUDs should not be, IUCDs, sorry, intrauterine devices should not be advised at all for that. And obviously they should not get pregnant again, because the pulmonary hypertension can progress pretty rapidly. So delivery history or the obstetric history is very, very important in a cardiac disease. Yes. Go to the next slide. Okay. Which are the heart disease that run in families?
Coronary artery disease.
Okay. They can be not so common. You've written sudden cardiac death and heart disease in families. Which are those diseases? Cardiomyopathies.
Cardiomyopathies,
yes. You have the hypertrophic and even the dilated cardiomyopathies. You have an autosomal dominant inheritance. Quite a large number of them have inherited properties that are there, and they can have sudden cardiac death. Okay. So that's about your history. Yes, you can come to that conclusion slide which you have written. This is fine. Yeah. Next. Okay, so what is your provisional diagnosis? You put up a list here. So
yes,
here
sir.
We have a 55-year-old female, isn't it? 55-year-old female who has progressive dyspnea for 6 months duration with PND and bilateral low limb swelling and with some palpitations that is there. So you think this patient has features suggestive of a heart failure. What heart failure? Left, right? The symptom is heart failure, that's all. We don't know about the disease. Is it right heart failure? Is it left heart failure? Or is it congestive cardiac failure?
Congestive cardiac failure, sir.
Why? Why is it not right heart failure only?
There is PND suggestive of left heart failure and edema suggestive.
So there is PND. There is PND. And then there is there is features of
fetal
edema. So it's a congestive cardiac failure in a 55-year-old, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive lady. So what is your first diagnosis that could be there?
Sir,
valvular heart disease. I think valvular heart disease is the commonest disease at age of 50.
Anemia.
You should have had, see, anemia. Somebody would have told that anemia, they would have asked her to put her on hematinics or asked her to get transfused, isn't it? Nobody will tell surgery for a anemia patient. You told this patient was supposed to be undergo a surgery or some cardiac procedure, isn't it?
Yes, ischemic heart disease.
The most common heart disease that you encounter is ischemic heart disease. Okay, so ischemic heart disease would be the first possibility, because here you have an elderly lady or a middle-aged lady, sorry, not elderly, middle-aged lady with progressive dyspnea and heart failure. So ischemic heart disease. So what is against ischemic heart disease? Anything against ischemic heart disease in your patient? Any symptom which you would have expected in a patient with ischemic heart disease and your patient
doesn't
have?
Angina pectoris. Angina.
So angina is not there in your patient. So that's one thing which could say that this could may not be. But do we have angina without, ischemic heart disease without angina? Can you have ischemic heart disease without angina?
Yes, sir, it is possible.
Yes? In whom do you get this often?
Those with diabetes mellitus.
Yes, those with diabetes because of associated autonomic dysfunction, we may not get angina. So you could get something called as angina equivalence. You should look for or symptoms of angina equivalence. So what are the angina equivalents you know of? Which would mean that there is an angina, but no pain.
Yes, sir. Sir, breathlessness, syncope.
Breathlessness. Okay, syncope. Yes, syncope. Breathlessness is plus minus. It's not necessarily.
Yes, sir. Fatigue.
Fatigue, very important. Fatigue. Fatigue,
perspiration,
syncope. Yes. Okay.
perspiration symptom.
Perspiration is a feature of the, it is a coexisting feature of an angina where during the episode there could be autonomic fatigue. So again, fatigue could be a feature of ischemic heart disease, which you could have got in the history. If this patient said fatigue, maybe you will have to go back and ask about the fatigue symptom. If that is there, that could also suggest a angina. So ischemic heart disease would be the first cause. Second cause.
Valvular heart disease, sir.
You'd still want to consider valvular heart disease. Okay. Why not anemia? Okay, anemia we have ruled out because she has been evaluated and not told to have anemia. Otherwise, anemia would be the second cause. Okay.
Okay,
If she
sir.
was not evaluated, but this lady has been evaluated and told that she requires a surgery, cardiac surgery. Okay, so valvular heart disease. So valvular heart disease would be the second cause. Which valvular heart disease are you thinking of?
Sir, it can be mitral stenosis probably. It could be aortic stenosis associated with mitral regurgitation or aortic regurgitation, sir.
So again, when the patient has a shorter history, a history is of only 6 months or history less than 1 year, it is always a regurgitant lesion which fails so fast. Okay, regurgitant lesion. So it could be mitral regurgitation or aortic regurgitation. So one of them can have this failure, which is happening pretty rapidly. Aortic stenosis, you should have had the symptoms. What are the symptom triad of aortic stenosis? Classical symptom triad.
Syncope, angina and dyspnea, sir.
What order will it come in? Which order, which is the first one?
Angina, syncope, and then
Which is
dyspnea,
the
sir.
order? Yes, angina, syncope, and dyspnea. So angina, syncope, and dyspnea. Here the patient does not have angina or syncope. Dyspnea is there. Aortic regurgitation, very much possibility, and mitral regurgitation also possibility. Rheumatic is less likely because of the short history. The
Yes,
history
sir.
is very short, that's why rheumatic is less likely. It could be non-rheumatic causes of mitral regurgitation, be it ischemic or any other cause that can produce. Okay, so that could be the cause of valvular heart disease with heart failure. Okay, any other cause you want to think of?
Sir, she is
You've
not a
written
hypertensive.
hypertensive heart disease.
Yes, sir. She maybe it was not hypertension was not diagnosed, sir. I thought.
If she was not evaluated earlier and she was presented to you only, then hypertensive heart disease could be considered because hypertension is undiagnosed unless it is checked. But this patient has already been evaluated, and if she had hypertension, it would have been told to her that she has hypertension. So it's less likely. Otherwise, at this age, ischemic heart disease, hypertensive heart disease would be the first two causes, and only then the valvular heart disease would come up. So valvular heart disease would be the third cause possibly in this age as such. Okay,
Yes,
so
sir.
we would still consider valvular heart disease possibly. Anemia we'll have to look into. Dilated cardiomyopathy. Okay, what could be the cause for the dilated cardiomyopathy? Dilated cardiomyopathy is generally not a disease unless it is inherited. It is an effect. So most common causes of dilated cardiomyopathy are why the heart will dilate. The most common causes IHD itself, ischemia itself. So when there is an ischemia, that part of the ventricle will get damaged and it will produce. So that's the most common cause. It could be toxins like alcohol, especially somebody who has a cirrhosis of liver. That means there is a significant amount of alcohol he has consumed. The same patient can have a cardiomyopathy also. So alcohol can be there. So these are the two common causes of cardiomyopathy that you could get in our part. Then we have the other causes which could cause. It could be infectious or immunological, and all those things are rare. So ischemic heart disease and alcohol are two important causes of dilated cardiomyopathy. Even vitamin deficiency like thiamine deficiency can produce cardiomyopathy. Generally, it produces a reversible cardiomyopathy that could be there. And in a females, any other type of cardiomyopathy you are aware of in a female? Any other cardiomyopathy has been described? Not only in females, but more in females. Especially when there is a postpartum. Postpartum is specific only for females. postpartum cardiomyopathy. Any other cardiomyopathy? We have something called as a stress cardiomyopathy. You heard of stress cardiomyopathy? It's called by a name called as Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. Of it, Takotsubo?
Yes, sir.
It's a cardiomyopathy.
Occurs in elderly women.
Excess of? Not necessarily elderly. It can be occurring in anybody. It is due to catecholamines. It is due to the increased levels of epinephrine, norepinephrine, etc. in the blood. And it's a reversible cardiomyopathy, but has a chance of recurrence and can produce sudden cardiac death. So those are the cardiomyopathies that could be there. Peripartum is different. Peripartum cardiomyopathy is different. That's in the peripartum period they can develop. Okay, so that is what our analysis of the history is so far. Any doubts and clarifications at this point? Otherwise, we'll proceed to examination. Any doubts or clarifications? Any questions are there in the chat, which or in the...
Sir, there are no doubts, sir.
No doubts, okay. Fine. I think then we'll proceed to the examination. Yes, you can continue, Ashwini.
Yes, sir. General physical examination. A 50-year-old female who is moderately built and moderately nourished is conscious, cooperative, and oriented to time, place, and person. Is sitting in the bed and appears tachypneic. Vitals. Her temperature was 98.4 degree Fahrenheit, febrile. Pulse 87 beats per minute. Regular rhythm, high volume, non-collapsing, normal character, vessel wall not palpable, no radioradial or radiofemoral delay, all the peripheral pulses were felt. Blood pressure, in the right upper limb it was 130/70 mmHg, and in the left upper limb it was 138/70 mmHg. Both the lower limbs, the systolic blood pressure was 158 mmHg. Respiratory rate, 28 cycles per minute, thoracoabdominal type. No other peripheral.
So, what's your inference so far? So, based on this, what are the inferences that you have? Based on the vital signs.
Yeah, pulse, there is a high volume pulse, sir. Blood pressure.
High volume pulse.
The blood pressure, pulse pressure is more than 40 mm of Hg. And also, the Hill sign is positive. Maybe aortic regurgitation, sir. Signs of aortic regurgitation.
So you say it is aortic regurgitation. So what is favoring aortic regurgitation, or what is against aortic regurgitation in your patient?
Sir, favoring is a wide pulse pressure and Hill sign. Not favoring is there is no. Collapsing pulse.
Yes. You said that this patient does not have a collapsing pulse, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So collapsing
yes, sir.
Pulse should have been there in aortic regurgitation. Here you're not having a collapsing pulse, though it's a high volume. White pulse pressure is there, 130/70, but it is not collapsing. So that's against aortic regurgitation, because aortic regurgitation should have a collapsing pulse, high volume collapsing pulse.
Yes,
so again, to say a collapsing pulse, the diastolic blood pressure should be how much?
Should be less than 50, sir. 50 mm.
Yeah, should be 50 or below. Okay. So yes, 50 sir. Or below, only then you could classically get the collapsing pulse. The wide pulse pressure which you get in aortic regurgitation. Systolic is also not very elevated. The diastolic is also not very decreased. So this is definitely a wide pulse pressure. But it is not collapsing. So that's a feature against the aortic regurgitation. So what are the other possibilities when you have a high volume pulse which is not collapsing? What are the other causes of high volume pulse?
There could be...
Yes, mitral regurgitation. Yes, that's what you think of. So mitral regurgitation is one. Then they've said about high output states. All the high output states can have a wide pulse pressure, be it anemia, be it thyrotoxicosis. Yes. Could be fever. All those things can produce high output state and You could get a white pulse pressure, but then it's not collapsing. That's it. Supposedly, it's aortic regurgitation, but the pulse pressure is not so low. So what do you think it is?
Maybe it is associated with stenosis also.
Okay, it could be associated with stenosis. More often, what is this patient suffering from? Which is maybe masking the signs of aortic regurgitation.
Heart failure.
Aortic regurgitation with stenosis is correct. But what else can mask the signs of aortic regurgitation?
Sir,
patient has profuse or significant heart failure that is there. If the patient has severe heart failure and aortic regurgitation together, the signs may not be seen. The peripheral signs may not be that florid. So that could be there. But collapsing is, even if it's not, other signs are not there, the collapsing should have been there. Okay, the collapsing, without collapsing pulse, to say aortic regurgitation is little out. Okay, why not mitral regurgitation? What would have been the pulse in mitral regurgitation?
The pulse is...
Again, mitral regurgitation is most often associated with...
High volume.
Atrial fibrillation would have been there. Would have had a regular pulse. Yeah, high volume irregular. High volume irregular pulse would have been suggestive of a atrial fibrillation. So high volume will be aortic regurgitation. High volume irregular pulse is atrial mitral regurgitation. Low volume regular pulse is aortic regurgitation, and a low volume irregular pulse is mitral stenosis. So that's the general combination that you could get. Yes. We can go to the next slide. What about the JVP? You're not told in that.
Sir, systemic
JVP you're telling later.
Yes, sir.
Okay, JVP can be told in the vitals also, but okay, fine. Yes.
Pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, and lymphadenopathy are absent. Edema, bilateral pitting type of edema is present.
So bilateral pitting type of pedal edema. So that could be due to the heart failure. Okay.
Yes.
Proceed.
Anthropometry, height 160 centimeter, weight 54 kg, BMI is 21.09 kg per meter square.
Again, when the patient has so much of edema, the BMI will be falsely high because of the edema. So much of edema, liters of fluid will be there in the body there. So the weight will be excessive. So you can measure the height and weight, but the BMI cannot be inferred. Just because she has a 21 BMI does not mean that she is normal when she has so much of edema.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you will have to look for other signs of nutritional deficiency. Fine.
Systemic examination. Yes. Cardiovascular system. Mm. JVP is 2 centimeters above the sternal angle and 2 waveforms are seen. It is not elevated, sir.
Is it normal?
It is normal, sir.
Not elevated. So
not elevated.
How do you say that this patient has right heart failure? You said that there is features of right heart failure, and but the JVP is not elevated. Why do you think like that? Why do you think the JVP is not elevated in this patient?
Because
you should have expected the JVP to be elevated.
Yes, sir. Because of regurgitant lesion, sir.
Why regurgitant lesion will affect the JVP is on the right side, na? Regurgitant lesion, if at all, mitral or aortic is on the left side, should not have affected JVP at all. If there is heart failure, why the JVP is not elevated in heart failure?
Maybe there
any
is
possibilities
associated. No, sir.
Hmm.
I'm not sure, sir.
Anybody else can tell me why the JVP is not elevated, if at all it's elevated? Not elevated? No, anemia. Anemia will have a very prominent JVP. The venous pulsations will be high. So if you have the signs of heart failure that is there, that is you have JVP, pedal edema, and a tender hepatomegaly. Which of them will be the first to resolve? Which is the last to resolve? Once you start treatment, yes. Diuretics giving, over diuretic usage, JVP can fall. But will it fall so fast that the pedal edema is still there and the JVP has fallen? JVP is the last to go. Okay, in right heart failure, JVP is the last sign to disappear. It will be prominent. So if you still want to make out that the JVP is significantly elevated or not, what do you do?
Sir,
you
hepatojugular reflex.
Okay, hepatojugular reflux. Did you do that? Did you do that?
No, sir.
So what do you expect in a patient who has right heart failure? What should happen to the abdominojugular reflex? It's not called as hepatojugular. It's called as abdominojugular reflex. What do you expect?
Sustained abdominojugular reflex.
Will be sustained. It will be sustained. It will remain elevated for more than 5 cardiac cycles. So that would be a sign of the right heart failure. Otherwise, to say JVP is not there. Are there neck pulsations? Multiple neck pulsations are there on the neck? Usually
no,
in aortic regurgitation, you have a very, very prominent neck pulsations on the right side. The carotid will be bounding. So the JVP might be difficult to see. That is one thing that you can make the JVP is elevated. But JVP has to be elevated in heart failure. Okay, proceed.
Yeah. Inspection. The size and shape of the chest appear to be normal. Trachea appears in the midline. Precordium, no bulging is present. Apical impulse is present in the left sixth intercostal space, 2 cm lateral to the midclavicular line. No other visible pulsations. No dilated veins, scars, or sinuses. So here the apical impulse is down and out, which is indicative of
so
volume overload, a dilatation of the left ventricle.
No, it is not indicative of a volume overload. It just indicates that there is a cardiomegaly. Does not mean there is a volume overload. Volume overload, what should happen to the apex? What happens to the apex whenever there is a volume overload?
Hyperdynamic apex, sir.
Yes, there will be a diffuse apex, isn't it? It will be seen in more than one space. Here you said that the apex is localized to one space. Okay, once you said the apex is localized to one space, hyperdynamic is ruled out. Okay, it's ruled out. Hyperdynamic has to be a diffuse apex. Once you have there is a cardiomegaly, that much can be told, and possibly there is a left ventricular enlargement because it has shifted down and out. Yes, proceed.
Palpation, inspectory findings are confirmed. Apex beat is in the left intercostal space, 2 cm lateral to the midclavicular line, and it was found to be hyperdynamic on palpation. Thrill or diastolic.
Again, the word hyperdynamic, moment you say hyperdynamic, it has to be not a localized apex.
Yes.
Hyperdynamic is
more than
a diffuse apex. Okay, it's a volume overload which has. Yeah, it may be two-thirds. More than two-thirds is more of a heaving apex, but if it has to be diffuse, it should be in more than one space to say it's a volume overload. To say hyperdynamic is a volume overload apex, it's a forceful and ill-sustained. So it has to be there in more than one space. Okay.
Okay, sir. Diastolic thrill was felt in the left third intercostal space. There were no epigastric or suprasternal pulsations, no palpable heart sounds. Parasternal heave not present. Percussion, cardiac percussion was not done. Liver dullness in the left fifth intercostal space. Traube space is resonant. Hello. Auscultation.
Just come back to that earlier slide.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So there's a diastolic thrill in the left third intercostal space. So
yes,
what
sir.
Is the relevance of that? Diastolic thrill in third intercostal space.
Sir, it indicates...
Which area is that?
Herbs area, sir. Hello?
It's a neo-aortic area. So you're seeing a diastolic... Yeah, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. Your diastolic thrill in the neo aortic area.
Indicates
possible valvular heart disease that we are dealing is.
Aortic regurgitation, sir.
So possibly out.
Hello. Hello. Hello, am I audible? Hello.
Are you
Yes,
able
ma'am, you're
to?
audible. Just a second. Yeah.
I think there is some problem with the network. I think it's pretty badly raining here. That's possible. So you said there's a diastolic thrill in the aortic area, in the neo-aortic area. So possible valvular heart disease, aortic regurgitation.
Yes, sir.
So proceed to the next slide.
Auscultation. Mitral area, S1 and S2 are heard normally. S3 is heard in the mitral area. There are no murmurs. Tricuspid area, S1 and S2 are heard, no added sounds or murmurs. Aortic area, A2 is heard, but it is muffled. And there is a mid-systolic murmur with grade 3 out of 6 with diaphragm. With breath held in expiration radiating to the carotids. Pulmonary area, there is a loud P2, and there is an early diastolic murmur heard, grade 4, with the bell, best heard in expiration and leaning forward. It is radiating to the apex. There is a narrowing of the A2 P2 split in the second heart sound. Second aortic area, that is the in the Erb's area, there is a early diastolic murmur of grade 4 which is heard, and there is no murmur in the infraclavicular Gibson's area.
What do you think is the cause for the aortic area murmur? Murmur in the aortic area is due to
Aortic regurgitation, sir.
aortic area. Aortic area. The first one. Mid-systolic murmur, you are told.
Yes, sir. That is due to stenosis.
That is due to stenosis. So you're saying it's a
Stenosis. Yeah.
stenotic murmur. So usually it's an ejection systolic murmur that you get there. Okay. And with the breath held in expiration. Again, the word radiating to carotid is wrong. The word that we use for carotid is conducting.
Conducting. Okay.
Aortic stenosis conducts to the carotid. So can you tell me what's the difference between radiation and conduction? Why should we not use interchangeably? Both mean,
Yes, sir.
what do you mean by conduction and what do you mean by radiation?
Conduction. I'm sorry.
So conduction is the word which we use specifically for aortic stenosis. Aortic stenosis, the ejection systolic murmur conducts to the carotid. So there is a continuity that is there, anatomical continuity that is there between the carotid and the aorta
Yes, sir.
that's
And
there.
the
So there is a
intensity
murmur that is
remains.
going through an anatomical continuity.
Yes, sir. And the intensity
Yeah,
remains the same.
intensity would be either,
Same
yeah,
or decreases with
it remains the
distance.
same or it increases with distance.
Okay, sir.
Increases, not decreases. Increases. In conduction, it is always increases.
Yes, sir.
Whereas in
And
radiation,
it
which murmur we are
decreases
telling
with distance.
radiation usually? Radiation. Which murmur do we describe with radiation?
Mitral regurgitation,
Radiation is
sir.
used for mitral regurgitation, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, mitral regurgitation murmur, we say it radiates to the axilla, where it is heard in a non-cardiac area. There is no anatomical continuity in the axilla. And the murmur intensity decreases with distance. So that is what we are talking about. So when you say of aortic stenosis, it is better to say it is an ejection systolic murmur and it conducts to carotid. So conducts to carotid. Okay. What is this pulmonary murmur? In the pulmonary area, you told me about a murmur. What is that murmur due to?
That is due to aortic regurgitation, sir.
Pulmonary murmur. Why are you
Sir,
saying it's aortic regurgitation, not pulmonary regurgitation? Why not pulmonary regurgitation? How are you differentiating? Pulmonary regurgitation also produces early diastolic murmur. Aortic regurgitation also produces early diastolic murmur. And you're in the pulmonary area. So why do you say this is aortic regurgitation and not pulmonary regurgitation? What made you differentiate the two? Both produce early diastolic murmur, na?
because of the narrow split, sir.
So one is on the left side, one is on the right side. So how do you differentiate right-sided versus left side? Anybody?
On inspiration.
Yes, so if it was a pulmonary murmur, it should have increased on inspiration. Here you said it is increasing on expiration. So whenever you
Yes.
have an increase in expiration, that means it is a left-sided murmur. So it's a mitral or aortic. And here, I don't think so. Pulmonary area, you will be able to hear the murmur so loud. It should be in the neo-aortic area. So I think the murmur is best heard in the neo-aortic area only. I think it is better to say the neo-aortic area findings before pulmonary area. So you can say about the aortic area, then you can tell about findings in the neo-aortic area, Erb's area, that there is an early diastolic murmur, which is grade 4, and it's heard with the diaphragm. Again, remember, bell is only used for only one murmur you use the bell for. That is which murmur? Bell is used for. It is mid-diastolic murmur of mitral stenosis.
Mitral
For all
stenosis.
other murmurs, you're using diaphragm. Please remember, bell is used only for mid-diastolic murmur of mitral stenosis because it's a very low-pitched murmur. The aortic regurgitation murmur is a very loud murmur. Okay, it's a very loud murmur. As you said, it's a grade 4, meaning that there is a trill there. It's a very loud murmur. You don't require bell for that. So bell is used only for mitral stenosis murmur. What are the other uses of bell? What are the other conditions you hear the bell for? What else can you use the bell
Tricuspid
for?
stenosis S3 and S4, sir.
Okay, so mitral stenosis, S3, S4, venous hum. Venous hum, that's the main things that we use for a bell for. Otherwise, this murmur, the early diastolic murmur, which is with the trill there, you can auscultate with diaphragm and making the patient leaning forward. Again, very important, please do not say radiation and conduction for diastolic murmurs. Diastolic murmurs are very localized murmurs. Okay, please understand. Diastolic murmurs are localized murmurs. They do not radiate to one area to the other. So don't use the word radiation for diastolic murmurs. The radiation and conduction is for systolic murmurs only. Okay?
Yes.
So this radiating to the apex is wrong. Okay? Because in the apex, you told me there is no murmur at all. No? Mitral area, there is no murmur.
Yes,
Right?
sir. Yes, sir. It's a mistake.
Then
Yes,
where is
sir.
the radiation to the apex? Again, diastolic murmurs, please don't say radiation and all. Okay. So again, the Erb's area finding has to be written in detail. That is grade 4, best heard in expiration, patient sitting and leaning forward. So this maneuver is called as sitting and leaning forward. Maneuver is called as
Arabs manual, sir.
it's Erb's maneuver. It's Erb's maneuver. Okay, whereas mitral murmurs is best heard. What position for mitral murmurs?
Mitral murmurs are best heard in left lateral recumbent position, sir.
Yeah, supine and left lateral, supine and left lateral, whereas aortic murmur is best heard. Okay, proceed.
Other system examination. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds heard in all the lung fields, bilateral basal crepitations heard, perabdomen soft, non-tender, no organomegaly, central nervous system, higher mental functions are intact, no focal neurological deficits.
Again,
Diagnosis.
that basal crepitation, the word basal crepitation, the word is not basal. There is nothing like basal in the lung there. You will have to say the areas, okay? So basal would refer to the infrascapular, interscapular, or infraaxillary areas.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Diagnosis, valvular heart disease in the form of severe aortic regurgitation with mild aortic stenosis and no atrial fibrillation in congestive cardiac failure, currently in NYHA class 3 with medications, with pulmonary hypertension and no evidence of infective endocarditis or embolic phenomena. Probably it may be due to calcific valve changes or ischemic heart disease or bicuspid aortic valve.
Okay, so the first thing you're told it is a valvular heart disease. So it is better to tell what type of valvular heart disease. Is it a congenital or it's an acquired valvular heart disease?
Acquired valvular heart disease. Or it could be
Right. So
congenital.
your diagnosis should start with that. Could be congenital. Okay,
Could be
then it's
congenital.
okay. Then we can keep it like that. But then the diagnosis should be congenital. There is nothing congenital mentioned here except for
Sir,
bicuspid aortic valve here. Okay. So valvular heart disease in the form of Severe aortic regurgitation. What made you say this is severe aortic regurgitation? So how do you assess the severity of aortic regurgitation?
Sir, severity of aortic regurgitation is based on the Hill sign, sir, if it is more than 60 mm of Hg.
Okay, Hill sign is the most important thing which would say the severity of aortic regurgitation. But the Hill sign here is how much? Less than 20.
Yes, sir, it was 20.
Isn't it?
Yes, 18. Sir.
It is mild aortic regurgitation. What are the other features of severe aortic regurgitation? One is Hill sign.
Then
what else can be there in severe aortic regurgitation?
Austin Flint murmur.
Okay, Austin Flint murmur is severe aortic regurgitation, correct? Then anything else?
Pulse,
which other peripheral sign?
Bisference pulse.
Bisference plus minus. Any other peripheral sign which is more common with severe aortic regurgitation? One is Hills.
Increased pulse.
One more
pressure.
Sign in the leg. One more sign in the leg, which is the femoral.
Femoral, pistil short.
Dorosiers. Okay. Dorosiers murmur. Dorosiers okay. murmur. Pistil short is seen in mild also. So here your patient does not have any peripheral sign and the Hill sign is less than 20. So it is not severe aortic regurgitation. So that we'll have to say it is mild aortic regurgitation. Okay. And mild aortic stenosis. Do you think this patient has aortic stenosis? Why do you say this patient has aortic stenosis? Why do you say this patient has aortic stenosis? What signs of aortic stenosis this patient has?
Sir, there was a narrowing of the split. And there was a...
That does not indicate aortic stenosis. Okay, there is a murmur. You're saying there is a systolic murmur in the aortic area, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So systolic murmur in the aortic area. Now, supposedly the systolic murmur, and whenever there is a regurgitation which is so severe, if you said that this regurgitation was severe, the murmur in the aortic area can be flow murmur also. When there is so much of flow occurring across the aortic valve, you can have a flow murmur also. To say it is organic aortic stenosis, that means there is aortic stenosis also, what would be the features that would suggest that there is AS with AR?
AS with AR symptoms, sir. It could be because of
symptoms. Both are same, na? Dyspnea is there. What findings would suggest that there is a organic aortic stenosis or there is definite aortic stenosis in the patient? Others can answer. What are the specific signs which could be there in aortic regurgitation?
Sir,
which would say that there is
carotid thrill. Palpable carotid thrill.
No. Carotid thrill will be seen in even in AR only. Yes. The first feature would be the blood pressure. If you have a lower systolic blood pressure, normally in aortic regurgitation, we expect a systolic blood pressure to be above 140. So the wide pulse pressure with the systolic above 140. If your systolic blood pressure is lower than 140, if it is 120 or something, then definitely we can suspect there is a coexisting aortic stenosis. Second, if you see the murmur, what is the specific feature that is in there in the murmur in an aortic stenosis, which cannot be there due to a flow murmur? What happens to the murmur? How is the shape of the murmur in an aortic stenosis?
It increases and decreases, sir. What is it called?
It doesn't decrease. No? It increases only and it peaks late. Okay, a crescendo murmur. It keeps on increasing. What we call it is the peaking of the murmur, the late peaking of the murmur. That is the hallmark of aortic stenosis. Remember, aortic stenosis, the flow as the systole pumping out goes on increasing. To the later part of the systole, the stenosis will worsen. So the murmur intensity peaks later. That indicates a severe aortic stenosis or a significant aortic stenosis that is there. So if you have a late peaking murmur with a systolic decapitation of the blood pressure, this could say that this could be aortic stenosis. So your patient's blood pressure is 130 So that could be saying that there is an aortic stenosis that is there in this patient. Okay. So it could be an aortic stenosis associated also. That could be explained possibly. And your collapsing pulse is also not there. One of the reasons could be, other than heart failure, it could be due to aortic stenosis coexisting. Okay. Then you said there is congestive cardiac failure. So what are the signs you got of congestive cardiac failure? Signs of congestive cardiac failure? So right heart failure, the signs you had were pedal edema. Pedal edema was there. You should have expected the JVP to be elevated, but that's not there. Left heart failure, what signs you got?
PND and orthopnea.
Signs. History wise, you had signs of left heart failure. You had crepitations. You had crepitations in the so-called basal area is what you said. Okay. So that would be suggestive of a left heart failure. You should have auscultated carefully for a third heart sound, S3. That would be a sign of failure. S3 was present. So S3 is a sign of left heart failure. That could be there. Okay. With pulmonary hypertension, what made you say there is pulmonary hypertension in this patient? What were the sign of pulmonary hypertension?
So left heart failure causing right heart failure, sir.
So pulmonary hypertension, the sign should have been a loud P2. Okay, a loud P2, parasternal heave if it would be there, and a murmurs in the pulmonary area which increases on inspiration. Your pulmonary area murmur was due to the aortic murmur because the aortic murmur was loud there. So it was heard in the pulmonary area. Okay, because it was increasing on expiration, you said, isn't it? So if you had a murmur in the pulmonary area which increased on inspiration, and you had a very loud P2, and then you had a parasternal heave, if it was there, and a palpable P2, then you would have said pulmonary hypertension. Do you expect pulmonary hypertension in a patient with aortic valve disease? Or pulmonary hypertension is a patient of mitral valve disease?
Mostly seen in mitral valve disease.
Yes, it is almost exclusive for mitral valve disease. If you get in aortic valve disease, that means there is a coexisting mitral valve disease. So you don't expect pulmonary hypertension in this patient. So you should write it as no evidence of pulmonary hypertension. Okay. No evidence of pulmonary hypertension, no evidence of infective endocarditis, no embolic phenomena. Okay, so now we have a patient who has a aortic stenosis and aortic regurgitation. Now, how do you say the etiology for aortic regurgitation? So what are the two types of causes which could be there in aortic regurgitation? It could be problem with the valve, or it could be problem with the
aortic root, sir.
Aortic root, isn't it? Aortic root is there. Yes, so aortic root or a aortic valve. So now how do I say if this is a root problem or this is a valve problem? So what are the things that help us to tell us whether it is a root or it is a valve? Then we can tell the etiology. Okay, somebody has told about Harvey's sign. Are you aware of Harvey's sign? Okay, so here, where was the murmur best heard for you? The murmur was best heard in the neo-aortic area, isn't it? Not the aortic area. Yes. That means the murmur was heard on the left side. Supposedly, the murmur was heard in the aortic area, early diastolic murmur, in the aortic area or on the right side. If it was heard in the right side better compared to the left side, yeah, that would be a feature of root dilatation because the root would dilate there. So right-sided, on the right intercostal space, second or third intercostal space, if you heard early diastolic murmur, it's more suggestive of a root pathology. Whereas if it's a valve, aortic valve pathology, it is more heard in the neo-aortic area. So that's the first feature. Second is the first, the aortic sound, A2. What happens to the A2 when the valve is damaged? Valve is damaged. So A2 becomes
A2 is soft.
So that means there is a valve which is damaged. Okay. The exception, please remember, the exception for that is a bicuspid aortic valve. You told one of the etiologies earlier, bicuspid aortic valve. In bicuspid aortic valve, the valve is it is bicuspid, it's not tricuspid. So the loudness is more. So you get a loud A2 in case of bicuspid aortic valve, whereas all other diseases, be it rheumatic, degenerative, infective endocarditis, anything else affecting the aortic valve, the A2 is soft. In your patient, the A2 is soft,
soft,
isn't it?
Yes, sir, it is soft.
Here your patient has an A2 which is soft and the murmur is better heard in the neo aortic area. So the possible cause is valvular, not due to the wall.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Now this patient has aortic stenosis also. There is AS with AR, correct?
Yes,
so
sir.
AS with AR, is it possible with the valve or is it possible with the wall?
It is possible with the valve, sir.
Valve or a wall? It's also possible only with the valve. It cannot be due to the wall. The aortic root dilatation cannot cause stenosis, isn't it? The root dilatation causes will only cause regurgitation. They won't cause stenosis.
Yes, sir.
So what are the three features that you have in your patient which is suggestive of valvular?
First is the soft A2.
Correct.
Second? Then
murmur is better heard in the
left side, in the herbs area.
Yeah, in the neo-aortic area.
Neo-aortic area.
Yeah, and the third is associated aortic stenosis.
Associated.
So there are the three features which are saying that this is a valvular problem, not a problem due to the root dilatation. Okay. So tell me some causes of valve. Tell me some causes of wall. What are the causes in the valve?
Yes, sir. It could be due to congenital bicuspid aortic valve or endocarditis.
Correct.
Endocarditis.
Correct.
Acute rheumatic fever.
Rheumatic heart disease. Correct.
It could be due to syphilis.
Degeneration. Syphilis affects the valve. Does it affect the valve or does it affect the root? Syphilis doesn't affect the valve. It affects the root, aortic root. Okay.
Yes.
Degenerative. Some connective tissue disorders. Which is the connective tissue disorder where the aortic valve gets damaged?
Sir, Marfan syndrome.
Valve. Valve, not the root. There are many diseases which affect the root. Marfan, Sirler-Danlos.
Mitral valve prolapse.
Yes. Mitral valve prolapse doesn't affect the aortic valve. Aortic valve can get damaged due to rheumatoid arthritis or ankylosing spondylitis. Okay, ankylosing spondylitis and rheumatoid arthritis. Okay. Okay, what are the causes on the root side? Root dilatation. Can you tell me some causes on the root dilatation?
Yes, sir. Aortic dissection.
Okay, that is acute. Then
Marfan
syndrome.
We've
already discussed Marfan syndrome, Marler-Danlos syndrome, yes. Then syphilis, as you said, syphilis.
Syphilis.
Yes. Syphilis causes
hypertension.
Dilatation.
Hypertension, sir. Systemic hypertension.
Hypertension is plus minus, doesn't cause regurgitation usually. Okay. What will happen to the second heart sound if the root is dilated? A2. What will happen to the A2? What will be the feature when the root is dilated? How will the A2 be? We said in the valve it will be soft, whereas in the root dilatation, especially in syphilis,
loud, sir.
The second heart sound will be the characteristic, very loud.
Loud.
And they call it as tambour, yeah. Tambour quality. It's very, very loud, like a banging. A2 will be seen. Okay. So here, based on your findings, it looks like it's a valve which is problematic, and the patient has both stenosis and regurgitation in a middle-aged lady. So your first possibility could be degenerative. Rheumatic. So what would be suggestive of a rheumatic? How can I say it is a rheumatic? What will help me to say it's rheumatic?
Past history, sir.
Past history, okay. Past history is okay. Examination wise, to say rheumatic,
associated,
you should
mitral
have
valve
involvement
disease.
Of mitral valve.
Mitral valve, yes, sir.
That's a very, very, without mitral valve disease, you cannot say that there is aortic valve disease. Very, very rare aortic valve disease in rheumatic. So mitral valve disease, if it was associated, if this patient had a mitral murmur there, or as you said, pulmonary artery hypertension, if it was there, secondary mitral, or an atrial fibrillation was there, then you would have said this patient could have had rheumatic Otherwise, at this age, it could be degenerative or rarely could be bicuspid aortic valve. But please remember, aortic valve, you get a very loud A2. Okay, it's a loud A2. It's an exception for the valve causes. So degenerative would be the first cause that could be caused in this patient. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that's how you give the diagnosis. And the last thing you're going to mention is the NYHA. NYHA class 3 or class 4 this patient is in. Any doubts or clarifications in how to give the diagnosis or how do you arrive at the diagnosis? Or any other questions that are there at this time?
So there were two doubts.
Yes.
The first one was, if pulmonary hypertension is absent, how did the right heart failure occur?
Pulmonary hypertension produces right heart failure in a long standing process. The left heart failure is the commonest cause of right heart failure because heart is a syncytium. Moment the left heart fails, the right heart will fail. So yes. Commonest cause for right heart failure is left heart failure. So this patient has left heart failure. This patient has left heart failure. So right heart failure is secondary to the left heart failure.
Yes.
Pulmonary hypertension can produce right heart failure without left heart failure being affected.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. So there were another doubt. What is the reason for postpartum cardiomyopathy?
Postpartum cardiomyopathy, many proposed mechanisms are there. Nothing proven. Okay. They say it is ischemia is there in this patient. And it could be some sort of a stress cardiomyopathy, though it does not belong to the classical Takotsubo pathology there. You don't get the dilatation of the, like if you do in a Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, if you do a CAT study, you can see the ballooning of the ballooning of the left ventricle. It looks like a octopus pot sort of thing. That does not happen in postpartum cardiomyopathy. So postpartum cardiomyopathy, pathophysiology, they say is like microvascular abnormalities that could be there, which could be increased due to the hormones that are secreted during that part. Again, it's not the exact mechanism of postpartum cardiomyopathy is not been described. They say selenium deficiency is there and there are many other pathogenesis which have been there. Yes. Generally resolves, but not to the level of Takotsubo. Takotsubo is complete recovery once the stress is relieved. Postpartum can have some amount of heart failure that can persist.
Yes, sir. So there's another doubt. How does root dilatation cause loud A2?
Yeah, when the root is dilated and then the valve is closing there, what happens? It is like a resonant chamber. The root is dilated. Like it's like a tambour word is like our musical instrument, tambura. You've seen a tambura, no? There's a
yes, sir.
Resonating hollow thing in the middle and then there is a tubular structure there. So it becomes like a resonating chamber there. The valve, that's the walls which are there, which are widened. It looks like a resonating chamber. That's why it becomes very loud.
Yes, sir. So one last question. Where is collapsing pulse can be seen except aortic regurgitation?
Collapsing?
Pulse.
Except aortic regurgitation. You can get it in all these conditions where you have a high volume states. You can get a mildly collapsing pulse. But the water hammer pulse is described only for aortic regurgitation. Yes. Collapsing pulse can be seen in other conditions, as you said, all the high output states.
Yes, sir. Done, sir. Thank you.
Any other doubts or clarifications? Otherwise, I think we can wind. I think any other slides are there?
Sir, investigations?
The general things. It's okay. Fine. This will skip.
Yes, sir. That's it, sir.
So this patient has a valvular heart disease and has heart failure. So your basic management would be to manage the heart failure. Yes, you will evaluate the ECG, X-ray and echocardiography was mandatory. You want to rule out what is the pathology and based on that, you will be proceeding further. You will be managing the heart failure first and then you'll be going for the specific valvular heart disease. So here the patient has AS and AR. So the patient can undergo aortic valve replacement. But always remember, whenever you do an aortic valve disease, you should always do a angiogram prior to that and rule out ischemic heart disease. So if there is an ischemic heart disease, you will have to tackle that in the same setting. You will have to do a CABG in the same setting of the surgery.
Yes, sir. Sir, one more doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Why is IV fluid restricted in high cardiac output or in anemia?
No, it can precipitate the ventricular failure. That's the only reason that it's restricted. It can precipitate a pulmonary edema. Even a blood transfusion, a large amount of blood transfusion in the patient who has a severe anemia can produce a heart failure, and that can precipitate a pulmonary edema. That's why we should restrict fluids.
Yes, sir. Done, sir. So any concluding remarks?
I think it was a very well presented case. So we had an interactive discussion, I think so. If this is a very common case that you would get in your exams also, though mitral valve diseases are commoner. Of late, we see a lot of aortic valve disease. The rheumatic etiology is going down and down. We get more of congenital cases like this, bicuspid aortic valve or other causes which could be affecting the aortic valve. And we have to know. So it's very important that clinical examination, the history, as well as the basic vital signs and the inspection and the palpation of the cardia will give you majority of the diagnosis. So you have to give good importance to these. And you will have to do a very meticulous examination, and your examination will always be giving you the diagnosis in more than 90% of the cases to the perfect level. Investigations will only help you. So you have to be very clear with the natural history of the disease and the what are the symptoms and signs of each of these valvular diseases.
Yes, sir. I think thank you, sir. Would yes.
Suffice. Okay. Fine. Yes. Thank you.
Yes, it was indeed a comprehensive clinical class. The discussion was very useful for us. Thank you so much, Dr. Arshit, sir, for teaching us and guiding us. We are ever grateful to you. It was a great effort by the presenter. We could learn a lot because of your well-prepared presentation. We also thank all the participants who were enthusiastically answering and were actively involved. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.